Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello and welcome to another episode of TV Guidance Counselor. My name, as always, is Ken Reed, and I am your TV Guidance Counselor. I appreciate you coming back to the show or checking it out for the first time. My guest this week is comedian Lillian Devane, who is very funny, Boston-based comedian. I do a lot of shows with her. She's always doing some interesting and strange things around town, does a lot of shows with a great comedian, Rob Crean. And she's from Florida, which comes up in the episode, and is stranger than I thought she was, but in the best way possible. So please enjoy this week's episode with Lillian Devane. Miss Lillian Devane, how are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good. Thank you for doing the show.
Oh, yeah. My pleasure.
Welcome back to the home. You've been here before.
Love it. It's my favorite kitsch hole.
Oh, thank you. Kitsch hole? That's I think I've been called that before. In traffic, someone's been like, you cut me off, kitsch hole. And I felt like I earned it.
It's not meant as an insult.
No, that's fine. Mm-hmm. Many things people yell at me in traffic I take as compliments.
You should.
So you picked a TV guide from March 3rd through the 9th, 1990.
Yes.
What drew you to this particular TV guide?
Well, first of all, on the cover, it's got Pee Wee Herman.
Who's very awkwardly photoshopped. Pre-photoshopped.
Right, it's a collage. Yes. It's a decoupaged on this. He's just in front of all of the adorably cartoonish Sesame Street characters.
The weird thing about this cover is it's, and people can see this on the Tumblr, but it's sort of a who's who of children's television people. It looks like what a child might make as a collage on their wall. But the weird thing is, it's so you got Kevin Arnold from Growing Pains, Wonder Years, the Sesame Street Gang, the Muppet Babies, Mr. Rogers, Babar, of course, Pee Wee Herman, just the word Nova. Because what child doesn't love Nova?
Notice.
Yeah, it's, of course, every kid's favorite show is Nova. Kids are like, I love Muppet Babies and Nova.
Sure.
Those are the two shows.
Close second, Nova.
Yes. So this has a parent's guide to children's television, which is the cover. And this is a pretty good guide in here. They kind of go through all the shows, tell you what the best for children 2 to 5 are, one of which is Shining Time Station, which I would not agree. The only time, though, that George Carlin replaced Ringo Starr.
Right.
I would like to see a reunion of the Beatles, well, pre-death, but George Carlin playing drums. I think that'd be pretty good.
I think everyone in the band could play drums, and Ringo is just the one they're like, that's fine.
Except for Ringo.
Yeah, exactly.
Keep him back there. Yeah, it's safer. It's fine. Yeah, he might be playing drums for John Lennon and George Harrison in heaven.
I hope it's a lovely image.
The best for kids 6 to 11, it does have Square One TV and Mr. Wizard's World. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you used to watch Mr. Wizard's World.
Yeah.
Don Herbert was a very, very odd man. And the show was all Canadian kids, which I never really figured out till later.
Yeah, they have nothing else to do, I guess, except...
It's just have an old man make them make bottles explode. Put this in the bottle. Okay, whoa!
That's boy.
Yeah, he came to my school, Don Herbert.
Really?
When I was a kid. Yeah, for some reason we got a lot of, I don't want to say celebrities, but we got a lot of high-profile people coming through our elementary school. We had Buzz Aldrin came with a real spacesuit.
Wow!
I got to put it on.
God, I think we just got drug lectures all the time.
Oh, we got that too.
But man.
So you grew up in Florida.
Yeah.
Isn't Cape Canaveral in Florida?
Yeah.
So you didn't have an astronaut come?
No, not to my, I mean, maybe, yeah, I don't think so.
I got to put on the spacesuit because I was tall.
Damn it.
Yeah, I was pretty excited. And then he's like, any questions about this? And my question was, did you pee in this? And he went, yes. Which, that's a legitimate question, like you're in space.
Sure. How does it come and go, you know?
I was a little bit grossed out. And when I was in the sixth grade, they teased this thing we were supposed to have that was a laser light show.
Mm-hmm.
And all year they're like, it's this guy named Dr. Laser or something like that.
Sure.
It's going to be an amazing laser light show. And it got canceled like 3 times. It got postponed. So by the end of the year, when we finally had it, everyone was like, this thing is the greatest.
Yeah,
this is huge. And it was literally a guy with basically a laser pointer and a mirror attached to a subwoofer. And he played music and he goes, the vibrations from the music will make the laser appear to, made air quotes and went,
dance.
No!
Yes, that was, fantastic.
Oh my god.
Yes.
That's
we
great.
Had the a cappella group who sang the TJ Maxx theme song come in and play for us.
What is the TJ Maxx theme song?
TJ Maxx. Yeah, this was in the late 80s. That was very exciting. So we were spoiled.
Okay, so you had the highs and the lowbrows of these things.
Oh, absolutely.
So,
it wasn't all education.
I don't feel too bad now.
All right. We had some Canadian rap group come. It was very weird.
Wow.
I think they were... Oh, one thing I remember. This is all coming... We haven't even got into the week here.
Yeah.
But we had Pepsi come in, and they did a multi...
The corporation Pepsi docked at
Pepsi
your school.
Came to my school, and they did a multimedia presentation with three projection screens that was just them playing Van Halen's Right Now for like an hour. It was basically an hour-long commercial for Pepsi.
Just an ad.
Pepsi.
That's brilliant.
Yeah. They're like, we're having a multimedia presentation.
Why don't more companies do that now? That's a great...
I think there's laws against
sure,
doing that.
Sure, that makes
which
sense.
Is, you know, that's Hey Obama's America, sadly.
Yeah, no,
Pepsi can't
right.
go in and market to children anymore.
Thanks a fucking lot.
What was the best, like, assembly or field trip you had growing up?
You know, that's a good question. I think... I feel like we had the... Nothing comes to mind as, like, an exciting... Like, we never had anything memorable. I always just feel like we went to those reenactor places. You know,
oh,
the
really?
Butter churny...
Oh, weird.
...kind of things. Because I can't think of anything... Actually, we went to, like, a cool island and, like, got seashells. I think I cut my foot on one.
An
it was a
island?
Horrible accident. Yeah, it was, like, Amelia Island. It's, like, an island off Florida.
Oh, weird.
So we go on cool... Like, you could go to beachy field trips.
But you were injured.
Cool.
Yeah,
but I was injured. And it was, like, a whole to-do, of course.
We go to factories a lot. Like, we went to the Teddy Peanut Butter Factory.
See, there's no factories in Florida. It's all just.
What's
like,
the industry? Just tourism.
I'll tell you this. My grandparents owned a sand mine. So that's what we... That's
what,
the, that's
the
what we're dealing with.
What was the used for?
Highway constructions. Concrete.
Oh, okay. So like mixing.
Yeah.
It wasn't like...
So not a lot of resources.
Yeah. It'd be funny if the sand mine was just gold everywhere and you had to pan the gold away. I got some sand here.
Chip away that shiny stuff.
What is this platinum garbage? So we're on March 3rd, 1990.
Yes.
It's 8 o'clock on Saturday night. What did you go with?
I started off with a bang, Friday the 13th.
Okay, the series.
Oh, fuck. Are you serious?
This is Friday the 13th,
the series. I was like, why is it an hour long?
Yes.
They must have cut it down for television. Tell
me
about the series.
This is Friday the 13th, the series. It is actually no relation to the movies at all, other than it was produced by a guy named Frank Mancuso Jr., who was the producer of the Friday the 13th series at Paramount.
This is blowing my mind.
Yes. So the series is actually pretty good. It's about two cousins who are romantically entangled.
No.
Yes.
Nope.
Filmed in Canada. They're not cousins. They're cousins by marriage.
Okay, sure.
Their uncle was a Satanist who owned an antique shop, and all of the antiques were cursed because he made a deal with the devil.
This is great.
He dies and leaves the antique shop to them, and then the show is them trying to hunt down these cursed objects that he had sold over the years, and it's sort of an anthology series. So there's like evil dolls and
they had like backstory, like their own little backstories.
Yeah,
that's
like
kind of genius.
Yeah,
actually.
It was pretty good. The haunted makeup kit.
Sure.
Stuff like that. It lasted 3 seasons.
Huh.
Made in Canada. David Cronenberg directed a bunch of episodes.
Why have I never heard about this?
It was in syndication. It was a first-run syndication show. It might not have aired in Florida. It aired at different times in each market. In a lot of markets, it was on like Saturday nights at 11 or 2 in the morning. It was usually paired up with... There were sort of 4 horror anthology first-run syndication shows. There was Friday the 13th, the series.
Yeah.
Freddy's Nightmares, which is the Nightmare on Elm Street series, which did actually feature Freddy, but was more like Tales from the Crypt. He just kind of hosted.
Right.
And then there was Monsters and Tales from the Dark Side.
Huh.
They were all sort of like that. So this was Friday the 13th, the series. It's a fun show. It's all available on DVD.
Well, I would have been happily surprised.
The main woman in it, she was an actress who went by one name... Roby.
Ooh.
Yes, she was a redheaded actress named Roby.
Roby.
And she put out an album where the big single was a cover of One Night in Bangkok by Murray Head. It's very funny. Because she's a very stilted actress, and so she's like, Bangkok, Oriental City. I might put a link to the Roby version of One Night in Bangkok on the Tumblr for
Please
this.
Please do.
Yeah, she married a prince and lived in some island off the coast of Scotland or something
after
that.
To be Roby, huh?
We all want to be Roby.
Wow.
It's Birobi. I think the African nation of Birobi. But it's a great show. I watched it every week. It was a fun show.
Yeah.
And even though you're disappointed that it was not the movie Friday the 13th, it was in fact the
Now
series.
That I've heard, I think I'd be on board.
Yeah. What you did pass up was the debut of a show, a drama, 1-hour drama on ABC called Help.
Hmm.
But HELP stands for something.
Oh, God,
It stands for the Harlem East Side Life-Saving Program. Teams cops, firefighters, and paramedics in an experimental emergency unit. In the opener, a young girl is found floating in a bathtub. A tugboat explodes. A rash of building fires appears to be the work of a young arsonist, and a cougar is spotted in an apartment building.
They're all connected pre-Cougartown.
This is like the big cat definition of cougar. Not just, as an old lady cruising for dudes. We gotta stop her. I've never seen Help, but it sounds like a fun show. I probably would have gone with Friday the 13th, the series as well. I think that was a good pick.
Thank you.
So 8:30, you didn't have to pick anything because it's an hour-long show that you've chosen. And really, to be fair, there's not much to pick from at that time anyway. 9 o'clock, would you go with?
I did Columbo.
Are you a fan of Columbo?
You know, weirdly enough, no. Well, okay. I watched my first episode of Columbo a few months ago out of sheer boredom.
That's how everyone watches the first episode of Columbo.
And it continues to be an experience of sheer boredom. But I don't know. I think it's an interesting, because it's the reverse. What's it? It's Hal Ketchum instead of whodunit, right? That's its legacy. It's the whole. Yeah. But yeah, it is just an excruciating.
Once you're in.
You gotta stay.
And this was after the show, the weekly show had been canceled, and they'd brought it back as a series of 2-hour movie of the weeks, and they would call it the NBC Mystery Movie sometimes.
Okay.
So this was a Columbo 2-hour movie here, so you're in for the night. This is a renowned artist employs a masterly Trump deal. I don't know what I've never seen that French. Do you speak French?
No, Trump.
D apostrophe O E I L.
Oh, Trump. No, I don't know.
I've never seen that French word. TV Guide using very obscure French in here.
Jesus.
To cover the murder of his ex-wife far from the studio where he supposedly was painting.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so it's a classic Columbo.
It's just a 2-hour thing, because all the ones I've watched are 2 hours. It's bizarre.
You've watched just the movies.
Yeah. I had no idea. Yeah, it is brutal. They're brutal.
You're like, well, there's my night gone.
Yeah,
Columbo. I would not have gone with Columbo. I would have gone with an all-new Golden Girls. Blanche's estranged sister pens a lurid novel that leaves Blanche livid, and Dorothy plays host to Stan's hardline communist cousin.
Oh, man.
What a B-story. You don't get commies in there that often.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess I'm just, like, punishing myself with the long, drawn-out crime.
Yeah, you're doing a lot of murder that evening. There's the Friday the 13th, which I don't know what episode was that night, but it could have been, it might have been, like, a haunted pen that used blood. There was that kind of thing.
It's a common theme, you'll see.
I think the most ridiculous cursed object on Friday the 13th, the series, was a haunted child's playhouse. It was like a combination of a dollhouse and a doghouse.
No.
And these kids would go play in it and bring other kids in there, and then the kid they would bring would get, like, eaten by the playhouse.
Holy shit.
Yeah, it was pretty fucked up. So at 9 o'clock, you don't need to pick anything because you're watching Columbo.
Yeah,
I would go with HBO showing a one night stand of Robin Harris, who's sadly no longer with us. Are you familiar with Robin Harris?
No.
He was an African American gentleman.
Sure.
He starred in the movie Baby's Kids.
Oh.
He was in the House Party movies.
Okay, sure.
He died. This one, Robin Harris, adult oriented routines on unemployment, babysitting, and Disneyland.
See, okay.
Which was the basis for Baby's Kids.
Oh.
Which came out. Have you seen Baby's Kids? Animated movie.
Okay.
Came out after his death. Mid-90s with some little kids with some real attitude.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, he was dating a woman who had named Bebe.
Yeah.
Who had some kids he had to watch at an amusement park. And that was Bebe's Kids. Now, at 10 o'clock that night, speaking of Freddy's Nightmares, that was on that night.
Oh, damn.
This episode, A Minister's Passion for a Death Row Inmate places him between her and the electric chair. But he may be burned when his intentions are discovered.
Whoa. Yeah, so many twists.
That is a twisty turny. That was as much as I like Friday the 13th, the series, Freddy's Nightmares was awful. I watched it every week, but it is the most community theater.
Well, that's why he had to go into other people's nightmares, because his own nightmares were fucking terrible, right?
Exactly.
So he could, boring.
They're just like, these community theater actors are no good.
Get out of my mind.
A lot of people got their start on that show, like Mariska Hargitay.
Oh, really?
And Laurie Singer.
Mm-hmm.
It was a very odd show with a lot of Brad Pitt. Was on Freddy's Nightmares.
Weird.
Yeah, he did a lot of TV.
Huh.
Some Growing Pains, lots of stuff. So Sunday night, 8 o'clock, what'd you go with?
Okay, this one was real hard. I just did, you know what? Nature documentary about gorillas.
Really? Really? Are you a gorilla fan?
Well, it's the Diane, it's like, it talks about Diane Fossey, right? Which made me think about gorillas in the mist, which made me think Sigourney Weaver.
I don't think you can have a nature documentary about gorillas that isn't about Dian Fossey. Right, that's the only... Unless it's about Coco and his kitten.
Right. Sex appeal or all ball.
Yes. So this is a study of Rwanda's mountain gorillas. And weirdly, they put gorillas in quotes. Which makes it seem like it's a racist show. Like some kind of coded, those Rwanda mountain gorillas. I don't know why. Gorilla's a thing. Like, that's not a real... in quotes.
Nope.
No, TV Guide, you used a very obscure French term and you're telling me that you don't understand how to use quotes. I think we all know what's going on. Shy and gentle apes whose inaccurate King Kong image has contributed to their decimation.
Yeah.
Yeah, that seems like kind of a bum out.
I know. Yeah, I'm kind of like a nonfiction gal a little bit.
So you like a documentary.
So I like to spice things up, start off a little serious and then, you know, work my way through.
Well, Lillian, if you like documentary and nonfiction... Yeah. I have quite a recommendation for you, alternate to the Gorillas show.
What?
It's a little show called America's Funniest Home Videos that is all real things.
I can't.
It's documentary.
Nope.
And in this episode, now keep in mind, TV Guy mentions this is just scheduled, so it may differ. So don't get mad if it's not exactly this. But a New York infant does a lip sync rendition of New York, New York.
No.
A Las Vegas man bowls a strike right through the wall of his home and also... water skiers. That's it.
Just fucking
water,
dorks.
Just people water
fucking
skiing.
Fucking nerds.
Yeah, I mean, that sounds... That's ticked all the boxes for you there.
Sure.
It's documentary. Mm. It's real life. And it's not depressing.
But she was like a, you know... She's like a rangy kind of bitch who then got
murdered.
So you're
like an outdoorsy person?
I am totally not. But I just... I'm into the... It's like lurid, you know? She got murdered.
So this is two nights in a row you've gone with murder.
I know. Doesn't stop there.
No, I'm sure it'll continue. The murder continues throughout the evening. So 8:30, you didn't pick anything because you're still watching the gorilla documentary, I assume.
Yeah.
What you passed up on was the short-lived half-hour drama Elvis, which was a dramatization of the 50s career of Elvis. It was a huge budget show. It was actually a pretty good show. Michael St. Gerard played Elvis, who was in the movie Hairspray. Tracy Turnblad's love interest.
Oh, okay.
He looks exactly like Elvis.
Yeah, yeah.
And this one, when Elvis and his band go on the road, the car and then the camaraderie break down as bass player Bill grows increasingly jealous of the show-stopping Elvis.
Well, yeah, that seems to be maybe the only theme.
Imagine that you're the three guys that back up Elvis. Nobody gives a shit about you.
No.
And they shouldn't.
Why would they?
I love Elvis. I watched this show for like the 8 weeks that it was on before it got canceled.
I am kind of more of a fan of, like, at least music-wise, of like sweaty Elvis.
Oh, absolutely. You 70s know? Elvis is far superior to 50s
Thank
Elvis.
Thank you. No one will believe. They think I'm crazy.
We're on the same page here. His voice was in fine form.
Yep.
He had like a 200-piece band and did these huge arrangements.
Yep.
Amazing stuff. Everyone's like, I like his rock and boring.
No, so rock
and
boring.
Garbage.
Overdone.
Yeah, you want this big, histrionic, 45 vocal group. Yep. Yeah, have you ever seen That's the Way It Is, the documentary? Or, you would love That's the Way It Is.
Yeah.
It's a documentary about Elvis' 1973 tour.
Whoa.
Where he's the first tour he did with this huge band. And so the concert footage is amazing. But there's all this footage of him, like, arranging the songs. And he was in good shape. 32-inch waist at the time.
Sure.
He's doing his karate on stage. making his awful jokes.
Uh-huh.
I read an interview with Ronnie Tutt, the drummer for his band at that time. He was probably the best drummer.
He was jealous.
I was jealous of him. But he's talking about how Elvis had a really weird sense of humor and had all these in-jokes that he thought you knew and no one knew what he was talking about. So he's like, one day I got this, it was a watch from Elvis, and it said, to Ronnie, love squirrely. I have no idea what that means. And he was like, right. And I was just like, sure thingy. I don't know what it means. I never know. It's just like all kinds of stuff like that.
Wow. That's great.
Have you ever heard Boston comedian Tony V's story about Graceland?
No.
So he's a big Elvis fan as well. And actually, my dad went to Graceland. I've never been to Graceland somehow. I'd like to go there.
Yeah, you definitely
have you been there?
No.
I'd like to go. But my dad went there and he called me from the jungle room. And he goes, this is exactly what he says. He goes, yeah, well, I'm at your buddy Elvis's place. And I was like, yeah, he goes, I'm in the jungle room. I guess Elvis thought he was pretty cool in the 70s. And I'm like, yeah, he did. It's Elvis.
He was
pretty cool in the 70s. But there's a book that the Walsh brothers went there. And Tony V's like, you got to go in this room. And there's a book in this like glass case you got to look at. And it's this philosophy book. And there's this, I don't remember the exact passage, but there's this like really philosophical quote. And Elvis has underlined it and wrote next to it, karate.
What?
Yeah, that's his note.
Oh,
karate.
Oh, my God.
Love,
I want to check out a library book that guy was perusing, you know?
You can't write in library books.
No, okay.
I remember I ripped a page out of a library book once. I feel bad about it.
Don't.
Well, I had a band at the time, and there was a book of photographs, and I just tore a page out and used it as the cover of our album.
It's for art. It's for
yeah, it's fine. It's fine. Upcycling. Yeah, it's educational purpose. It's fine.
Totally fine.
Our library, the librarian in Melrose, was he used to do the sign language for the church show on Sunday mornings. Wow. Like in Florida, I imagine you probably had church on TV on Sunday mornings.
Yeah.
So this guy was the guy in the little circle in the corner, and he was kind of a dumpy guy with glasses. And he would go from zero to ballistic in 4 seconds. Like he was so
with
easy
his
to
sign
make
with his signing.
He wasn't deaf.
Right.
But yeah, he would sign while he yelled at you because I think it was just like automatic.
That's awesome.
So he'd be like, "You goddamn kids," and he'd be signing. So this kid named Chris, who was a dummy, there was an elevator at the library that only went up one floor because it was for handicapped people and not for everybody.
Sure.
And you had to use a key, and he was like, "Can I use the elevator?" And this guy was like, "No, you don't need that elevator." And he's like, "I do, I have colitis." And I don't think he knew what colitis was. So he gets in the elevator, and then the elevator got stuck between the two floors, and he started crying. And then all I remember is this tubby sign language guy going, "I'm leaving you in there because you deserve it, you little brat." And he left the kid in there for like an hour.
What?
So we were all studying while this kid was crying in the elevator.
That man should not be an educator, maybe.
I don't know if he counts as an educator.
Yeah, I guess
is a librarian an educator?
I don't know. Maybe just a keeper, a curator, maybe.
A curator, yeah.
Yeah.
He might still work at the library for all I know.
Jesus Christ.
But that kid Chris was stuck in the elevator for... I mean, he deserved it. But,
okay, yeah.
Fair enough. So 9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
I did Tracy Ullman.
Right? I mean, that's a good move. Did you used to watch Tracy Ullman when it was on?
No, I like... Oh, I think I was too... I mean, I've been 5 years old at this point.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't have. But, you know, I know her. I respect her as a, you know...
As a musician.
Yes.
She had some hit singles.
Yeah, yeah.
So this is obviously where The Simpsons got their start as well.
Yep.
Have you ever seen the show?
Mm-mm.
It was a pretty great show. It was really weird.
Yeah.
She did, as you would imagine, it's Tracy Ullman.
Right.
She does a lot of weird stuff. So this one is the completion of her new design kitchen has Sarah Downey reminiscing about good and bad times with her husband, Greg, played by Dan Castellaneta, who's Homer Simpson.
Yep.
Very weird show. It doesn't get rerun very often, not on DVD. It's not as popular, easy to find as like Tracy Takes On or other stuff.
Right. Because she do like, it's like a sick, is she do characters at
it's
all?
Characters. She's, it's sketches.
That's what I remember. Like.
It's sketches, but they're almost like tiny sitcoms rather than like a broad Saturday Night Live and Living Color sketch. They're all character pieces. So some of them would be just like a couple eating dinner and it's like a sad conversation. Like it's not even a sketch or she's just on the phone. It was a really weird show. It was one of the weirder sketch shows I ever remember watching. I watched it every week. I definitely would have watched it at that time.
Yeah.
What you did pass up though on A&E was a show called Reno's Cabaret Reunion, which was the first of an AIDS benefit concert celebrating New York City's Reno Sweeney.
Oh, I saw that.
Featuring Phoebe Snow, Ken Page, and Janice Ian. Boring.
Yes.
Boring city.
Yep.
So I would have gone with that as well. 9:30, what'd you go with?
Well, I didn't know how long that show was because it didn't
tell
me.
It's a half hour, yeah.
So I didn't know. So I just went. I went for MASH for the next time block because I
was
just like.
Did you used to watch MASH?
Here's the thing. I just watched the movie.
Okay. Robert Altman.
Yep.
Fantastic movie.
It is, except I was like, oh, this movie is so great. It's a classic. And then I realized that the movie is just about sexually harassing a woman to her breaking point.
Yes, that's pretty much exactly all the movie is about.
And nobody cares.
No,
there's
no
repercussions.
The war.
Right. Bigger fish to fry.
You know, I think that's true in the military today.
Yeah.
I think we're seeing that now.
Yeah. Well, there's some depositions happening.
Yeah, but the show was very depressing. Mm. I actually got to meet Robert Altman.
Really?
When the Walsh brothers come up again, Boston comedians who now live in LA, they got into the HBO Aspen Comedy Festival in 2006, and I invited myself to go with them, which I did, and Robert Altman was there. He was showing Prairie Home Companion. It was like 2 or 3 months before he died, so I very briefly talked to him.
Wow.
It was pretty big moment in my life.
Yeah, yep.
But yeah, I hated the MASH TV show.
Really?
My uncle would always watch. It just seems so old. I don't like war stuff.
Really?
And I recognized that it was a quality show, but I just couldn't get into it. I don't know why.
Yeah, the only thing I know is the whole, like, the chicken thing. That's all I know, and that's all you gotta know, right?
Yeah.
Just know a cultural reference.
I don't like Jamie Farr.
Really?
Something about him is very off-putting. Jamie Farr is in a... Here's the best thing Jamie Farr said. It's a movie called Curse 2, The Bite. And it's a sequel to the original Curse.
Sure.
And in this movie, this guy gets bitten by a radioactive snake, and his hand turns into a snake.
What?
And his girlfriend's trying to save him, and Jamie Farr is like a snake bite expert. I highly recommend you go on Netflix, you rent Curse 2, The Bite, and you will not be disappointed.
Wow. So if I haven't seen the original Curse, can I follow Curse 2?
You can, because it's more of an anthology series. So the original Curse, if you want to see a prepubescent Will Wheaton in tidy whitey underwear,
go on.
Rent the first Curse.
Okay.
Because it is an unofficial adaption of H.P. Lovecraft's The Color from Outer Space,
Jesus.
Which is about a meteor that lands in a town's water supply and sort of makes them all go crazy. But it's creepy. It literally, Will Wheaton's like 10 years old in underwear for 90 of the 95 minutes of the movie.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. Someone's like, you know, I like this Stand By Me, but there's not enough leech scenes in it. I think if we could make a movie that's all the leech scene from Stand By Me, we'd have a big moneymaker here. That's exactly what they did. So I don't think I would have gone with MASH. I was not a fan of MASH. I absolutely, without question,
yes,
would have gone with SCTV Network on Nick at Night. Maybe my favorite sketch show of all time.
I didn't even see that on there. Yes. I totally would have done that too.
I love SCTV so much. There's two things my wife and I watch every night when we go to sleep, and we rotate. We watch all of Mystery Science Theater 3000.
Mm-hmm.
There's 200 episodes, so it takes most of a year.
Sure.
And then we switch to SCTV Network 90, and we watch that for another six
months.
That's
a great tradition. I love that.
We've gone through the show many, many times. I do want to mention this. At 11 p.m. that night on Caroline's Comedy Hour, the comics on the show were Sue Kalinske, Boston comedian Teddy Bergeron,
what?
Mike McDonald, also from Boston, and host Carol Leifer.
Wow.
Just as a fun fact. So we move on to Monday night. As I always say, the saddest night of the week. You've gone back to school. You really need something to take you away.
Sure.
What do you go with?
This was tough because, see, the thing is, I want to go for the movies, but then that just knocks out
so much
time.
You're out for the night if you go for the movies.
So it's tough. So I decided to go with Moonlighting.
Moonlighting is a great show.
Yeah.
One of my favorite shows, absolutely. This is a rerun of Moonlighting by 1990. Was this a show that you've watched frequently?
I watched it. I did. I kind of felt like I was always watching something, like, kind of bad. Do you know what I mean?
Because it seems a little adult.
It's a little risque. Sexy. Sexy.
Yeah. Oh, it absolutely is. Well, you know? Cybill Shepherd, I mean.
Right.
Although for some reason the lady's like Bruce Willis.
Yeah, he's a babe in that. But I think she, because like my whole life I've always wanted to be an ice queen. It's like I wish people thought
she's
the
ultimate.
The ultimate.
Have you read her autobiography, Civil Disobedience?
Oh, no.
Very good. She dated Elvis for a short time,
really?
Actually. Yes. Very, very good book. Highly recommend Civil Disobedience.
That sounds
great.
It
is on my wall of celebrity autobiographies. but you'd like to borrow it. I actually think I have two copies
of
it.
That's great. Yeah.
But yeah, this was on Lifetime. So Lifetime used to be a pretty good network for rerunning hour-long dramas in the early 90s. They rerun Spencer for Hire, Moonlighting, 30-something, The Days and Nights of Molly Dodd.
Yep.
They had some pretty good programming. So this was Moonlighting re-airing on Lifetime. I, however, on a Monday night in 1990, was watching My Two Dads.
Sure. I get that.
A show, an interesting show.
Mm-hmm.
Did you ever used to watch this show? So this was Paul Reiser's first sitcom.
Okay.
So it was Paul Reiser and Greg Evigan, and this is the premise of the show. They were both having sex with this woman. She got pregnant and had a child, and then she died.
Yeah.
And they don't know who the father is, so they both move in together to raise this girl, played by Stacey Keenan, and that's the show.
There seemed like there'd be a way to sort of solve...
Yes, so they addressed that in the second series. They were like, here's a test, we can tell you the dad is,
and she went,
you
know
what? I don't want to know.
But
I felt like this show, they wanted to make a show about two gay dudes.
Right, and they just...
With a daughter,
too...
and they're like, no, it's much more acceptable if it's just some whore.
Right. like, a dead whore is,
People are way more comfortable with someone who sleeps around and we don't know who got her pregnant than two loving gay dudes raising a well-adjusted teenage girl. No one's gonna buy it.
Oh God, you're so right.
As long as we could say, hey, this woman had sex with these two dudes in a 2-week window.
Yeah.
Hey, Maury Povich.
Maybe same day. We don't know.
Could have been the same day. We don't know.
Yeah.
They didn't get into that. But this particular episode, after his arrest for an environmental protest, Joey, who was the artsy one, played by Greg Evigan, who sang the theme song to the show, by the way. That was a trend you don't see too much these days. Well, most theme songs now don't have vocals.
They don't have, vocals.
There are so many sung by the lead actor.
I feel like there was a 90s thing, too, because like the Andy Griffith Show theme had words originally. They took them out.
Right.
And there's just the whistle,
right,
which we all love.
Yeah. You can put your own words.
Yeah,
in.
Yeah.
It's like a Mad Lib. But Greg Evigan, who he was sort of a heartthrob in the 70s.
Yeah.
The song was just, he was like a Don Johnson type, had like the scruff, and the song just went like, "You can't count on me," which is great because then Paul Reiser went to play he wrote and played the piano on the Mad About You theme song.
Oh my goodness. Look at that.
Yep. And that had lyrics, but they didn't know how to play them.
I
think we should bring that back. I'd like to see like maybe one of the people from The Walking Dead singing a theme song to that, or Mad Men.
Mm-hmm.
I've never seen that show, but I assume the theme song goes like, Mad Men.
Yeah, yeah, it's like just that. A loungy.
Yeah. So My Two Dads would have been my pick there. I did pass up MacGyver, which is the silliest show on television.
Yes.
It's part one of two. MacGyver joins an archaeologist on her quest for the Holy Grail.
Okay.
That is the episode. So, 8:30, what'd you go with?
Well, it's Murphy.
You did an hour.
Well, yeah, I didn't. See, that's the thing. Some of these, I'm like, I don't fucking know. I thought Moonlighting was an hour. It's half an hour?
It is an hour.
Okay.
So you're watching all of it.
Right. Murphy Brown, is
at
that?
9 o'clock. Yeah. Murphy Brown. Yep. So at 8:30, though.
Wait, I thought it was at 8. Am I crazy?
So we're using a central time,
right.
We got confused here. I'm translating for the East Coast people, but yeah, Murphy Brown was on at 9 East Coast, 8 o'clock central time.
Yep.
I would have gone with a movie. I did like Murphy Brown, but this is a repeat. And the movie is Heathers. One of my all-time favorite movies.
It's a great movie.
Yeah. Saw this in the theater. It was the double feature of Winona Ryder Love that year between Beetlejuice and Heathers. Heathers is a great movie.
Yeah, I love it.
The guy who wrote that never was able to follow up. He tried.
Really? What else did he do?
He wrote a movie called Meet the Applegates that stars Ed Begley Jr. as a sentient giant cockroach. From the rainforest, who can impersonate human beings, and him and his family try to infiltrate a suburban neighborhood to take them down from the inside.
Yeah.
It's a weird movie.
It sounds real weird.
It didn't do well.
No, I wouldn't think so.
But Heathers, I absolutely love. I wonder if what, like, a current teenager would think of Heathers.
I don't know. I mean, it's, like, super... I mean, I guess in all movies with high schoolers, they're all, like, really adult.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But that was like, I mean, it's pretty sophisticated stuff.
But they were, I think almost everyone playing an adult in that, teenager in that movie was
pretty
a teenager.
Young. They're pretty young.
Yeah. But I wonder if kids, it seems, that movie seems way ahead of its time.
Mm-hmm.
So when I watch that now, it seems kind of like what society's like
now.
Yeah,
like super dark school violence.
Yeah, and just like the pithiness of everybody. And I wonder if kids now would just be like, this is boring.
Yeah. It's
maybe.
I mean, yeah, it's totally horrifying.
Martha Dump Truck.
It's good.
Martha Dump Truck.
Big fun.
Yeah. It's teenage suicide. Don't do it. So Murphy Brown, this episode, is snowed in on a publicity stop. Murphy goads the normally frosty Jim into warming up to a woman at a hotel bar. I don't know if I want to see Jim warm up to a woman. I don't know if I'm into that. So I think I'm sticking with Heathers on that
one. I think
that's
a good choice.
9:30, what'd you go with?
See, I'm all screwed up now with the timeline.
That's fine. So let's say, what do you pick for 8:30?
Well...
Central time.
See, and now I did like the hour. So I have like Star Trek Next Generation.
So did you watch that?
Yeah.
Here's the weirdest thing.
Okay.
I never watched Star Trek The Next Generation. And literally every single one of these I've recorded with every single one of my friends all picked Star Trek The Next Generation. All these people watch this show and I would have no idea. Like, if I lined up all my friends and were like, let me just pick out who watched that, I maybe would pick like 4 people.
Huh.
But it's everybody.
Weird. That makes me, I don't know. I like
Are
that.
You into sci-fi generally?
No.
So that seems to be what everyone says as well.
It's the show that got me, I guess.
What? So do you like it now after that, or do you only like that
There's
show?
There's a like all my friends are now watching on Netflix who never watched it
and
in the
90s,
and they're super into it.
So it's just, is it the soap opera nature of it? Is it just like an exciting, I could never get into it. I've never been a sci-fi person.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's got these like very it's like a very like liberal, like learning about other cultures kind of thing.
Right.
So it's got all these great lessons.
So it's for hippies.
It's very it's kind of hippie. And then there's all these like it's a ton of like sexy. There's like all these, you know, it's like it's like General
Hospital.
I don't
think anyone's ever described Star Trek The Next Generation as sexy.
Well,
if I had to sum up Star Trek The Next Generation in one word, it would be sexy.
Okay, well, you already mentioned Will Wheaton, which we know sexy.
Is he hunky?
Yeah, I had a little crush on him.
Okay.
He's like my age. He's like a younger, he's like trying to, very ambitious.
Plus,
the name alone.
What girl doesn't love a dude? His last name's Crusher.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
It's just built in, made for it. His mom, Beverly Crusher, very like, you know, she's like a career, she's a
empowered
scientist, a
woman.
Doctor. She's sleeping with the captain of the ship.
Was she?
Hush, hush.
I had no idea about
Jean-Luc.
That.
Jean-Luc? Yeah. Okay. And then there's like fucking whore Deanna Troi.
No one likes her.
No one likes her.
Weird accent.
No. And the best thing is that when the one, I forget what season is, but they're like, you know what? You really need to put on a Federation uniform.
Yeah.
What are you doing?
She's
and I'm
very
like,
low
thank
cut.
Thank you. Like, right, yeah. She just because she's a guidance counselor, she gets to be a
slut. Wasn't she psychic or something?
Yeah. You know? That was her whole, she got to sit on the bridge of the ship just because she could be like, I think you're feeling something. Well, that's not.
She was an empath.
Yeah. And it's just.
Yeah. I don't think there's a place on a ship for an empath.
Not a woman in general, but especially not. Yeah.
So it was like, a woman constantly in her cycle.
Yeah.
That's
right?
What she was. But like in a good way.
Yeah.
In a good way.
Yeah.
Yeah. I couldn't. I've tried to watch it. I actually purchased the first season on Blu-ray to try and get into it. I liked the Borg.
That's a, it's fascinating,
creepy.
Right?
Yeah, they were kind of creepy.
I think
like
it's cool.
That.
That's the cool backstory, intense backstory.
Yeah. And I stood about 2 feet away from Jonathan Frakes one time.
Oh,
yeah.
Interesting.
Who directs now. He directed many episodes of Burn Notice, which I do love.
Really? And I've Burn never seen that show.
Burn Notice is awesome.
I only know that sketch, the
like, sorry. Yeah, it seems to be everybody. I was having a really bad night one night. I was doing a show in New York and some comic made fun of Burn Notice.
Yeah.
And I like snapped and got him against the wall. And I was like, what's your problem with Burn Notice? I was like, you never fucking seen it. You've never seen it, have you? And he was like, no. And I was like, you're just using it as shorthand for a bad show, and you never even seen it.
That's amazing.
And this kid was like, I'm sorry. I'm a little.
You had to like buy a shirt. I'm just imagining
that's pretty much
a couple inches off the floor.
Yeah, but it's a fun show. It's basically the A-Team.
All right.
Bruce Campbell's in it from
the
Evil Dead movies. It's great. And the main actor is from Boston.
Oh.
It's from Amesbury, actually.
Done.
He's very Boston. There's a lot of, guy, and that kind of stuff in it. Because he has to go undercover as a scumbag often to infiltrate these
gangs.
Oh, and
that's a classic code
Always goes Boston accent.
Makes sense.
Yeah, it's
great. I would.
It's great.
Yeah.
So anything else that you picked on Monday night?
I did. Yeah, I know, me too. I did Mr. Ed.
Really?
On
Nick at Night.
I used to watch a ton of Nick at Night.
Oh, I did too, but Mr. Ed was probably my least favorite show on Nick at Night.
I think. Now, looking back, I'm like, was the whole thing, did he have to keep the horse a secret? Was that the whole thing that nobody could know it was like?
He had to keep that it talked a secret.
Right, but the horse was just like, it was like half in his house.
Yeah, that was weird. I've never known anyone that owned a horse.
Yeah.
So I was just like, yeah, well, you keep the horse in the house. That's what happens, right? You have a horse house with the...
Yeah.
And my grandfather lived in a ranch house in Brockton,
mm-hmm.
and I always thought his house looked like the house of Mr. Ed, because it was very 50s,
yeah.
And he had this giant St. Bernard dog that kind of went, they had like a half door.
Like the saloon-y kind
of doors. Yeah, it was very much like the Mr. Ed house, so
it's
to me,
crazy.
I was like, oh, this makes sense,
yeah.
I imagine.
Yeah.
I always thought that show was just about a man with mental illness.
But like, it's like his Harvey, like it doesn't really...
Yeah, there's no horse,
yeah.
Let alone a talking horse. A lot of 50s and 60s shows were about keeping secrets.
Yeah, you're right.
Bewitched, I Dream a Genie.
Yeah.
It was all...
It was the culture of the time. There was a lot of... To keep
secret
behind
keeping?
Closed doors.
We keep magic a secret.
Yeah.
Talking horses.
Things that could change the world.
Yes.
I guess if I had to talk, it'd be like, it's not that interesting of a secret.
Because you know what? What the hell's a horse going to say?
Yeah, I'm
like,
not interested.
You know how many people I know that talk that I'm not interested in hearing talk? Like, never mind an uneducated animal that just sits in a barn all day.
Whose only view is just through your house?
Yeah,
like,
he doesn't even have thumbs. Like, it's not like he can do anything interesting.
No.
So Tuesday night, 8:00, what'd you go with?
I did Matlock.
Really? So you're going with all the procedural shows.
Yeah, it's kind of...
Is that your thing?
It's kind of my thing. I loved I actually did watch Matlock a lot. I find Andy Griffith very comforting.
Really? I couldn't get into the Andy Griffith show.
Really?
Yeah, especially after Floyd the Barber had the stroke.
Yeah, that's a sad...
Very creepy.
Yeah, I know. But I think, because my, he's like Southern, it kind of reminds me
so
a little bit.
So do you identify as Southern? Because I don't think of you as very Southern.
I know. Well, I am. I'm like a sixth generation Floridian. So my family has been there for a long time. And we're like Central North, so they've got accents in the whole Southern,
Southern
deal.
So Central North is like where Orlando is?
Kind of, yeah. I'm like Gainesville and then Tallahassee.
Okay.
So there. So we've been there for a long time. The whole cracker kind of.
Yeah,
like
moonshining.
Whatever. Yeah, whole deal.
Possum eating.
Yep. My dad would like, frog gigging, that whole thing.
Frog gigging?
Yeah.
Is that where you shine a light in their eyes and then you poke a stick on them?
Yeah, you spear them and then you get the frog legs and you string up. Like,
he'd eat them?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you guys would
family.
Eat frog legs?
Yeah, and what else?
Do you ever crave them now?
Like, no, I think it was like a little bit, I was a little bit young for the bony, weird. I don't. It seems like a lot of work for a tiny little. real thing. Right?
I've had alligator before.
Yeah, I've never had that.
It tastes, it really does taste like fishy chicken.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
It's kind of what they are, I guess.
Yeah, which sounds like a really bad rap name. because you've lived up here for a while, probably like 10 years now.
10 years, yeah.
And do you ever want to move back there?
No.
Like, yeah, I couldn't imagine.
No, absolutely not. It's really boring, and it's just, it's a sad, you know, it's a sad place. Of every single.
I really didn't, I remember I worked for this job that I had to travel like 1 or 2 weeks every month. And two of the places they went were Austin, Texas, mm-hmm. and Orlando, Florida all the time. And I never wanted to go there. And I would go to Detroit because it was way more interesting. And they're like, don't you know, like Orlando? And I'm like, no, it's the worst.
It is really,
everyone on the planet who's awful is in that airport at one time.
Yep.
And there's nothing new. Like, everything's new. There's nothing interesting. Did you ever go to like Universal Studios or Nickelodeon Studios when they were filming things?
I never had to see the filming stuff. I always wanted to, though. I thought that would have been, like, awesome.
Because Nickelodeon shot a ton of shows there.
All their, like, game shows, right?
All their game shows. And Clarissa Roundhouse, which was the worst show they ever aired.
Oh, God.
But then also USA Network shot Swamp Thing.
Right.
And Superboy shot down there.
Yeah, they had, actually, we have, like, a cabin in the Ocala National Forest, and it's overrun with monkeys from all the Tarzan films.
What kind of monkeys?
Whatever monkeys they had in those
chimps
films.
Chimps and stuff?
No, like swinging tree monkeys.
Oh, like Capuchin.
Yeah, because they, like, in the 30s and 40s, when they filmed all those movies in Florida, they're just like,
let them go.
They left all the animals, and so all these weird, crazy animals.
So you're in this cabin on vacation, and there's monkeys on the roof and stuff?
Yeah, I mean, there's not, like, they're not like, coming. It's not like a, like, packs of monkeys. And yeah. Yeah, but it's one of those weird things where they like they filmed all these movies and still like
that's
pythons are like all over the place, people's pets. It's a mess of a state.
There was an amusement park in Rhode Island called Rocky Point, and there's a great documentary called "You Must Be This Tall to Ride This Ride" about mm-hmm. Rocky Point. And in the 1930s, they had a zoo there with monkeys, a bunch of chimps and stuff. And there was a hurricane, and they all got loose. And the monkeys lived in the woods and on the beach and in, like, the haunted house
for decades.
Oh, my
God.
They also had a guy named the Amazing Electric Boy who had been struck by lightning and lost his arms and used to dive. Oh, yeah, this place, Rocky Point, amazing.
Wow.
I saw Samantha Fox there in a roller rink. I was 10 years old. I was eating clam chowder on roller skates watching Samantha Fox, which sounds like a weird dream.
Yeah.
Like, so I'm on roller skates, right? I'm eating clam chowder for some reason, and Samantha Fox is playing. It doesn't make any sense. That's what we did in New England down in Universal Studios. I forget what even time we're at.
I think Matlock, I think it's
an
hour.
Oh, yeah, Matlock's an hour, yeah. So this is an episode where Julie makes news when she defends a man charged with killing a newspaper editor and runs into her ex-husband who's prosecuting the case. Andy Griffith never did it for me. I don't know if I come across as extremely New Englandy. I probably do.
Yeah.
But thank you for that. But the Southern stuff really...
You can't. It's too folksy.
Something about it really
weirds
made me
out?
Uncomfortable. Yeah. Also, I should mention at this time you passed up every kid's favorite show, Nova. And this episode, I mean, we all remember this one as kids. They showed us this one at school. High energy physics experiments in the race for the top. The exclusive top quark are examined. So there you go.
Oh my God! No.
I would have gone with Rescue 911.
I see.
I enjoy reenactments.
Me too, but I passed up Unsolved Mysteries too because that was a little too scary for me.
That was scary.
Scary.
Rescue 911 was for people who wanted to see bad reenactments, but not be scared. And in this one, the acting, horrific.
Yeah.
In a good way.
Yeah.
This one is a New Mexico teen swept into flash flood, a skydiver knocked unconscious over Arizona, a confrontation in an Indian grocery store between the police and a gunman, and the New York City Fire Department on its busiest day of the year, July 4th.
Hey now.
Yeah, this sounds like a pretty fun night.
That does.
Yeah. So, 8:30, you didn't need to pick anything because you're watching Matlock. 9 o'clock, where'd you go?
I did Roseanne.
Classic. This is a repeat. This is the Halloween Tunnel of Terror episode.
Mm-hmm.
Always a great episode. It's Halloween in March, that famous thing we all know. And now, since this was a rerun, I, although normally would have watched Roseanne, I would have gone with a movie, science fiction film, called Runaway, starring Tom Selleck.
Interesting. Never heard of it.
This is a movie starring Tom Selleck and Gene Simmons of KISS.
Oh.
Gene Simmons plays an evil robotics genius who makes killer robot spiders and heat-seeking bullets in the future. And Tom Selleck goes after what they call runaways, which are, I can just read the description here. It's Tom Selleck is a futuristic cop stoically defending a city from haywire robots.
What?
Here's the thing, written and directed by Michael Crichton.
What?
Yes. TV Guide only gives it 2 stars.
Well, I
think it's a fun movie.
Really?
Kirstie Alley's in it.
Okay.
When she was still trying to do a movie career.
Yeah.
It's a pretty fun movie. I saw it in the theater with my dad. He told me that's how the future would be. 1984 came out. Yeah, he's like, this is exactly what it's gonna be like. I'm like, Gene Simmons is gonna make evil spiders. Tom Selleck is gonna, because what happens is like,
I can't believe you didn't just kill yourself. You know? Like, that's what I'm in for.
Like, this, what's the point?
Prophecy.
We're all gonna have to have mustaches like Tom Selleck in the future.
It's not worth living.
I can't. The mustache. Oh no.
Yeah.
So 8:30. I mean 9:30. You didn't have to. Yes, you did Roseanne.
I did Roseanne, and then I was like, I kind of fudged it and did the like 9:45. Like I.
That's fine.
You went with Halloween. 15 minutes. Yeah. Had
Halloween
a little,
4.
Yeah.
The Return of Michael Myers.
Yeah.
So have you seen this before?
No.
This is not the best sequel.
Right.
This stars Danielle Harris, mm-hmm. who was on Roseanne. She played their neighbor. And this movie is from 1988, I believe. It had a direct follow-up with Halloween 5. So Halloween 3 was called Season of the Witch.
That's the one with
the killer masks.
Yeah.
3 More Days to Halloween.
Thing, yeah.
I love that one.
Yeah.
Michael Myers is not in that one. So due to outrage, they brought him back with Halloween 4, The Curse of Michael Myers, The Return of Michael Myers. It's the most like the first one.
Okay.
It's enjoyable slasher movie.
Yep.
A lot of murder.
Yeah.
Still with the murder theme.
Yeah.
Do you read about like serial killers?
Yeah,
and really?
One of those people.
Who's the most fascinating one?
I used to be like in high school, I was super into Ted Bundy because he
was
killed
handsome.
In like all, he was very handsome, number one. And he killed in all the cities I'd lived in. Like,
it's very Florida.
He ended up in Tallahassee, he killed in Gainesville. Like, he had a.
So it was aspirational.
His life path. But then I used to do this whole thing where I like go to the library and I'd be like, can I see your back files in the
right.
library? I felt like I was like
can I take the elevator up to your back files?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I felt like I was like kind of like a gumshoe.
So you thought you were going to crack these cases?
Even though he's like on death row. Like
yeah.
It wasn't a case.
I think I know who did it. I know who did the Ted Bundy murders, everybody.
Yeah, it was
15-year-old Lillian has cracked this.
It's gross. And I actually had this, like, I think this freaked my mom out. I wasn't like a troubled child necessarily, but I had handwritten a list of all of his victims, the day they died, the day they disappeared, the day they were found, how they were killed, like what they were wearing when they were last.
Did you carry this with you at all times?
It was like a folded up, like it was weird.
Would you just take it out and review it?
Like
waiting for the bus?
Marianne was still, yeah, no, I don't know why I had it. It was just helped me like compile this information. It's weird.
Are you over that now? Do you still read about that stuff?
I do. It's like it's just such a dumb thing to be like, it's like everyone's into the like murder stuff.
I don't know if everyone's into the murder stuff.
It's like kind of it's like a thing people, you know.
Yeah, I read an interesting article about how serial killers are a myth, basically created by the FBI so they could sell books.
What?
And that like half the people who have all these murders pinned on them maybe did like 2 murders.
Weird.
But I don't know how the validity,
yeah.
validity of that. But yeah, Ted Bundy was an interesting one.
It's just, yeah, he did. He had a lot of like the whole, you know, he was
my
like
my arm's
helpless.
Broken, get in
yeah.
the van.
Which
yeah,
it's like, and then it kind of like made
you know
him
who used to
like,
terrify me was the Night Stalker.
Oh my God, Richard Ramirez.
Yeah. Do you remember there was a Punky Brewster episode about the Night Stalker?
No.
Yeah. So Richard Ramirez was a rapist murderer.
Yeah, horribly.
Terrifying.
Yep.
Home invasions. And there was an episode of Punky Brewster where she's scared that the Night Stalker is going to come into her window at night and kill her because she saw it on the news. And the episode's supposed to be like, no,
oh,
kids, don't worry about the Night Stalker.
Right.
But in order to tell us not to worry about the Night Stalker, they had to tell us about the Night Stalker.
It's the worst thing, it was just totally random. Like, he would pull off a highway and just go into a house.
Yeah, because he was, like, robbing.
Yeah.
The guy was just fucked up.
Yeah.
It was because of Metallica, mostly.
Yeah.
He was really into them. And my dad would always go, I'd be like, I'm nervous about this Night Stalker.
Yeah.
He goes, that's in California. They do that there.
Yeah.
That doesn't happen here.
Rock and roll and the beach blanket bingos.
Yeah, they go nuts. They go kill people.
That's gross.
Yeah,
bikinis.
We didn't have a lot of New England serial
it's
killers.
It's too cold and people are too private, you know? It's like, don't leave their house.
You just described 2 conditions that would probably be appealing for a serial killer. No one tells secrets. The ground is frozen and covered in snow for months. People don't see each other for months and months at a time and don't think it's strange.
I think of it more as like domestic abuse, like
okay.
right for that. You know?
Yeah,
I mean?
Like everyone's cooped up. Like Shining.
Right. Yeah,
you think
exactly.
Shining. Yeah,
exactly.
Fair enough. I've been to the Overlook.
Really?
Not the Overlook. It's the one in
yeah, it's called something else.
Estes Park, Colorado.
Colorado.
Yeah, I've been there. It was exciting.
Wow.
Yeah.
Same carpet.
The carpet was different.
Yeah.
The carpet was different. Yeah. So all this murder,
okay.
And you've never been, no one's attempted to murder you.
No.
Do you attribute that to your savviness about serial killers?
Right.
Like,
I think the ultimate irony in my life is that I would be, like, I kind of had this thing, I'm like, what if I murdered? because I'm so, like, in that, you know what
so
I mean?
So you
like,
believe in the power of irony so much that you think that you'll be murdered?
I don't know. I guess I don't know if it would be ironic, necessarily.
Have you ever heard Debbie Harry's Ted Bundy story?
No.
So Debbie Harry is from Blondie, as everyone knows.
Yep.
In the 70s, she used to hitchhike home sometimes. She used to wait tables at either Max's Kansas City or CBGB's. So she gets in this car with this guy, and it's Ted Bundy.
Oh, my God.
And she looks, and the doors have been gutted, so you can't open them. And so, from the inside. And so, she ended up putting her hand through the window and opening it and jumping out into the street.
Holy shit.
And then she didn't think about it. And then later, when they caught Ted Bundy, she's like, it was that guy.
That's fucking crazy.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Debbie Harry, almost killed by Ted Bundy.
Don't hitchhike.
So, yeah, I wouldn't have gone with things about serial killers. I would have gone with Runaway. So you're watching Halloween 4, and that's fine. That's fine.
All right.
Let's move on to Wednesday night.
Yep.
What would you go with at 8 o'clock?
I did Unsolved Mysteries again.
So, did you like the serial killer things on this?
Well, I feel like they were always kind of... They weren't that exciting, right? There was like, it was like, oh, we got to pack in four weird little things, right? It was like a disappearance. They're
yeah,
like
they usually
disappearing.
You know which ones always really bothered me?
What?
It'd be like Lost Loves.
Oh, God.
Or like, we had an affair for a weekend in 1944
yeah.
and I never saw her again. And then they reunite them. Well, like, I don't
yeah.
want to see their finer Lost
no,
Loves. That's
gross.
Not interesting.
Who's the guy? Who's the host? What's
Robert
his name?
Stack.
Right.
From Caddyshack 2.
Right. Okay.
Most people know it's Caddyshack too.
I kept, because like, then I was like, oh no, it's Adam Walsh's dad, but that's
no,
America's Most Wanted.
That's America's Most Wanted. He
yeah.
was a badass.
Yeah. He's
so
awesome.
Did you follow that Adam Walsh case?
I actually just watched the made for TV movie recently.
Because that was in Florida.
Yep.
He got decapitated
yes.
at a mall,
yes.
right?
Yes. They think it was, what is it? Otis Toole.
Yeah. Well, no, but Otis Toole and Henry Lee Lucas
right.
are just.
They're
they
famous
were,
fibbers.
Yeah. Well, because they were mentally handicapped
mm-hmm.
gentlemen who they would be like,
yeah,
yeah I killed them.
Oh,
sure.
Yeah.
Yep. Have you seen Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer?
No, that I didn't like that.
That is very disturbing.
I don't want to.
Very disturbing.
Draw
Michael
a line.
Roker, very, very scary. So this is Unsolved Mysteries. A report on a Nazi war criminal named Rudolf Hess suggests that a double may have served his prison sentence. Also, the search for a missing Montana woman.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think they're unrelated, those
yeah.
two stories.
Okay.
Like, did you watch, like, I Know My First Name is Steven?
I read about that. That
TV movie is fucked
I don't
up.
Want... You know, his brother ended up
being
a serial killer.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah.
I had read about that. I remember there was one of the things that scared me the absolute most on Unsolved Mysteries was this teenage girl disappeared.
Yeah.
And some guy was, like, 3 years later was jogging, and he finds a Polaroid on the side of the road. And the Polaroid is these two girls in their underwear tied up in the back of a van.
Fuck.
And they think, and it looks kind of like one of the girls, and they showed the fucking picture.
Are you serious?
The real picture. I was like 10 years old, and I'm like, this is the most terrifying fucking thing I've
oh
ever
my
seen. Like,
God.
Knowing that it was a real photograph.
Like a snot, like about to be.
I don't know what the hell. I'm like,
bad.
Why are you showing? Like, this isn't helpful.
That's awful.
Yeah, but the reenactment, here's the only saving grace. The reenactment of the jogger, this actor was like, doop, 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 whoa, like does this total overreaction to this Polaroid. But then showing the real Polaroid freaked me out. And I remember I was on a Wikipedia reading about Unsolved
yep.
Mysteries. Cases
yep.
and I that one pulled up and someone posted the friggin
Jesus
picture in the entry and
Christ.
I didn't sleep that night. I didn't sleep that
I'm
night.
I'm imagining it and it scares me.
It's terrifying. So I think I would have gone with Growing Pains that night.
Yep.
With a $5,000 inheritance from their grandparents, Ben starts spending, Mike goes shopping for a car, and Carol thinks of a perfect thank you gift. I remember this one. It's a pretty nice episode.
Okay.
There's no Nazis or serial killers on Growing Pains. I'm going with that.
All right, fair enough.
So, 8:30, you don't have to pick anything because you're still watching Nazi Gold.
Right.
I would have gone with Head of the Class,
okay.
which was a show that, to me, is the most accurate representation of going to high school in Manhattan that ever existed.
Yeah, okay.
Because I don't know anything about going
yeah,
to high school in Manhattan. 9 o'clock, what'd you go with?
I did Green Acres.
I love Green Acres.
Yeah,
Green
right.
Acres. It's a spinoff. Did you know it was a spinoff?
Of
Petticoat Junction.
That's what I was going to say.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay,
yeah.
Right.
Green Acres is a totally underrated show.
Mm-hmm.
I think that show, I'm surprised that hasn't found a new audience with today's television viewers because it was so, it broke the fourth wall at the time. It was very self-referential.
Right.
It had crazy jokes that were almost like the Simpsons level
yeah.
of jokes. What a smart, weird, funny show.
Yeah.
I think people write it off as like a dumb 60s show.
And they like slept in the same bed too, right?
They did, yeah.
Yeah, and
she was,
like
there was
things.
Tons of sex jokes. Yeah. Eddie Albert is one of my favorite actors of all time. He does angry better than anybody. Because that show is just him wanting to punch
out.
Everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
Like there'd be these people like, oh geez, and he'd be like, God damn it! Like he's just, every single thing he says translates to God damn it.
Yeah,
like you bonehead! And what a great show. He was a war hero. He saved a whole ship of people in World War II. Eddie Albert. Yeah. Fascinating guy.
Crazy.
Total badass.
Well, that show is like, it's like the art of compromise, you know?
Yeah.
It's just,
And just the crazy plots that fold in on themselves. Arnold Ziffel, of course, mm-hmm. who got drafted into Vietnam. Do you remember that episode? They drafted Arnold Ziffel. And it ended up being this very subversive anti-war episode that was very funny. Yeah, Green Acres is well worth watching over and over again. Plus the great Mizzy theme song, who also did the Addams Family theme.
Mm-hmm.
Every man watched Petticoat Junction for the same reason.
Right.
But Green Acres was a much, much better show.
Yeah.
It was a lot funnier. I think that's a great, great choice. You didn't watch Jake and the Fat Man.
We're on the same page.
So I would go with Night Court because I watched Green Acres in the mornings. It was on at 6 a.m. here. But this Night Court episode has a huge guest star. Harry helps Yakov, played by Yakov Smirnoff, extend the visa for his loving father. Mac buys a lemon of a washer dryer, and Dan cuts a rug with some help from Roz. I love Night Court.
Here's the thing: I've never seen Night Court.
You've never seen Night Court?
I know everyone. Yeah, I know. I should watch it. Right?
Did you watch a lot of sitcoms in the '80s?
I mean, I was alive in 1980, starting in 1985.
That's fine.
So
yeah,
you know.
Well, Night Court aired in syndication for years and years. Do you ever watch Barney Miller?
No.
Oh, you'd love Barney Miller.
Really?
Yeah, I got all angry about that for some reason. God damn it. I love Barney Miller! But Barney Miller, you should watch Barney Miller.
Okay.
I recommend it. But a lot of the people that worked on Barney Miller went on to do Night Court, which was a slightly sillier show. Actually, Night Court's almost like if you combine Barney Miller with Green Acres.
All right.
In tone. Also, Eddie Albert. Excellent hair.
Mm.
Really good hair.
All right.
So where are we? 9:30?
Yes.
Did you go with Donna Reed?
No, I didn't. What did I write? Oh, I wrote, watch half an hour of Dear John? And then switch to Quantum Leap.
Yeah, so Dear John was only a half hour show.
Okay.
It was based on a UK show called Dear John that was much, much sadder. Have you ever seen Dear John?
No, what is this? It's like the AA, there is like a...
It's about people who are middle-aged and are either widowed or have been left.
Oh,
so a Dear John letter.
Right.
And they have a group that meets twice a week called the One-to-One Group.
Oh, my
and
God.
And Judd Hirsch stars in it, who's the saddest man on television.
I love him.
There was sort of a swinger played by Jerry Burns, who was also on Burn Notice and is from Cambridge, Mass., named Kirk, who was like the breakout star. The UK version was much, much sadder and darker. But this one was a pretty funny show. So this is Afraid He's Becoming a support Group Addict. John, played by Judd Hirsch, takes a Friday night off to wing it on his own.
I kind of have a crush on Judd.
He's a weird looking guy.
I know.
He's great in Ordinary People.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
were you a
good.
Taxi fan?
Ish. Yeah. I watched him.
He was on a show that I really wanted to like called George and Leo.
Okay.
That was Bob Newhart and Judd Hirsch playing old men that lived together because their kids were married. One of their kids was played by Jason Bateman.
Yeah.
And it just didn't work. They live on Martha's Vineyard and it doesn't work.
That's
Judd Hirsch plays like an ex-mobster.
Oh, weird.
Yeah, very strange.
A Jewish.
Jewish ex-mobster.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't even think he's playing Jewish, which,
yeah,
I mean, it's Judd Hirsch.
You got it,
yeah. So you watch Quantum Leap. I've noticed most people who like Star Trek The Next Generation also like Quantum Leap.
Yeah.
Quantum Leap was like Star Trek The Next Generation for people who go to church. That's how I describe it.
I don't know, though. I mean, Scott Bakula was in a lot of dresses.
It's very Jesus-y,
it's
though. It got overtly Jesus-y later.
Did it?
Yeah, so Quantum Leap, at first, they were just like, he's just doing good deeds.
Right.
But then around season four, they're like, for Jesus.
Really?
Because on the Halloween episode, he fights Satan.
No.
Yes, and then it became overtly God had his hand in things.
God, see, I think I just was into the whole... It's kind of like, you know, like the Bugs Bunny thing, you know? It's like a...
You like guys in dresses?
I don't know, like there is something oddly satisfying about him just... You know what I mean?
Wearing a dress?
I guess...
Judd Hirsch in a dress.
The old...
Boom.
Okay, I'm not
Judd Hirsch in a dress who murders people. I think we just pitched a $1 million movie here. It's going to be huge in Florida.
Oh, my God.
So aside from the Scott Bakula dress action, Did you watch Enterprise? Because he was the, was it Enterprise that he was the captain in?
No, I didn't. I was strictly Next Generation. I would watch some like of the
Deep Space Nine.
No, I didn't like any of that. I only like maybe a couple of the original just for the kitsch.
Yeah, I love the 60s Next Generation.
Yeah, which is
series.
Great. I love you. But yeah, I was only Next Generation.
Did you ever
loyal.
See Lord of Illusions?
No.
Lord of Illusions is a movie from 1996, directed and written by Clive Barker, where Scott Bakula plays a private investigator who investigates supernatural things, like murderers. And it's about a cult serial killer.
Oh, cool.
I think you'd like it. I think you'd like it.
All right.
You should go with it.
Yep.
So we move on to Thursday night.
Yep.
8 o'clock. What'd you go with?
I did Taxi. You know,
Judd Hirsch.
Yeah,
so you're watching a rerun of Taxi. You didn't go with Father Dowling Mysteries, which was a little off for you because I thought, hey, you're watching Matlock and Columbo, you go with Father Dowling Mysteries.
Nope.
But no, you went with a rerun of Taxi.
Yeah,
this one, the cabbies volunteer to drive Alex to Miami to meet the daughter he hadn't seen in 15 years. So some Florida content there.
Yeah.
That's a pretty sad episode. I would have gone with Cosby Show. This is after studying long and hard for an exam and still getting a lousy grade, Theo believes he may have a learning disability.
Oh, God. That also sounds sad. This is a bum-out week.
We all believe Theo had a learning disability. 8:30, what'd you get with?
I did Different World.
I love A Different World.
Really?
Great show. Did you watch it then?
No.
Do you know what it is?
Kind of.
It's a spinoff of Cosby Show.
Okay.
It was about a black college.
Right. Helen. Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Lisa Bonet went there.
Yep.
She later left.
Yep.
So this one is Whitley, played by Jasmine Guy.
Yes. Okay. And she's got the whole crazy voice.
Yes.
With the
she's
weird
Southern.
Accent.
Yeah. She's from Boston, which is hilarious. Yeah. She has a touch of senioritis, but her job prospects that look a little wan. Hmm. Wan. Who uses the word wan?
Uppity.
Meanwhile, Ron's sister Rachel visits, and Ron's just like a father to her.
Hmm.
That's quite a B story.
Yes.
I normally would have watched Different World, but tonight there was a very special show on called the Glenn Miller Band Reunion that I think I would have watched.
I saw that. It's 90 minutes.
Ken. It's 90 minutes. Original members of Glenn Miller's Army, Air Force, and civilian bands taped in 1988. These guys could be 70 years old. I want to see 70-year-old
swinging.
Men swinging.
Yeah.
That's what I'm into. 9 o'clock, would you go with?
Cheers.
Yeah, Cheers. This is a great episode of Cheers. In this one, Carla agrees to split Eddie's estate 50-50 with his other widow until she finds it's $50,000 in insurance money. Meanwhile, Woody worries about a 100% nude scene.
Whoa.
No follow-up to that. That's it. That's all it says. This is a pretty good episode. Is Cheers what made you want to move to Boston?
No, it didn't. I think just getting out of Florida was the only
thing. How'd you pick Boston
of
all places?
My sister went to Berkeley.
Oh, what instrument did she play?
You can't even say that without laughing.
Like, I can't.
Like,
I really can't.
Not even trying.
No.
She played a bass, a stand-up
bass.
And
how often does she play that bass now?
She sits in my cousin's house.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I went to Northeastern, which is right by Berkeley.
Yep.
And I commuted, so I had a lot of time to kill between classes. And Bobby McFerrin used to teach at Berkeley. And I saw him every day.
Oh, God. That's sad.
I was in a Starbucks near Berkeley with my friend Phil. And I didn't drink coffee at the time. And Phil ordered this drink, some kind of latte. And this homeless guy looks at it and looks at him and goes, "That ain't no drink for a man." And Bobby McFerrin looked and goes, "He's right." It was the best thing Bobby McFerrin's ever done.
Amazing.
Yeah. So your sister went here and she was like, "I checked it out. It's pretty good. There's no serial killers."
Yeah. You're
and you were
fine.
Like, "I'll go."
Yeah.
So you didn't go to college here.
No, I did. It was like big city for me. I transferred from like this tiny school in Florida to the first school that would accept me, which was Suffolk University.
Oh, yes. That was my safety school.
It should have been my don't go here school. But here's the thing. Could be a bright star at Suffolk University. Got a lot of scholarships. Because they're like,
you're
can
smart.
Read.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, they said it to me. They said, "You're can read."
Yeah.
So you can go here for free.
Yeah, yep.
And I went to Northeastern instead, which was a mistake.
Well, you know, college in general.
Yeah, it's true. So were you like, it's not like Cheers?
Well, there are a lot of weird drunk...
There are.
Surly people here.
And Suffolk is actually right by the Bull and Finch.
Yep.
Did you ever go in there?
No.
Really?
Yeah.
You should go now.
I guess so.
So you need to go and rent Lord of Illusions.
Okay, and then...
Go to Cheers and get drunk. And then go watch it.
I actually really want to go to the fake Cheers place.
Oh, in Faneuil Hall?
No. There's there. And then there's the outside that they use for the, like, the shot.
That's the actual Bull and Finch.
That's what it's called?
Yeah, it's the Bull and Finch
Because I've done a thing in that hotel.
Yeah, it's in the basement. That's...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, that's the name of the bar?
Yeah, Bullfinch Pub. Yeah, they bought the layout.
I see.
So when you go down
like
there,
set, it's like,
exactly
right.
like
that's awesome.
The show. Yeah,
I'm going. Let's go.
Yeah, all right. We'll do that tomorrow. Okay. So 9:30, what'd you go with?
What did I do? I totally skipped 9:30.
So there's a show called Grand On, which I loved.
Yeah, what the what does
it
that
was
mean?
Kind of a remake. It was a show very much like Soap, if you ever watched Soap.
Mm-hmm.
And it was about this small town and the various social levels of people and how they interacted. And the main business in the town was a grand piano company. And so it was about rich people and their housekeepers. Oh. But it was sort of a dramedy. Michael McKean was in it. Bonnie Hunt was in it. Probably my favorite human being on the face of the planet.
Bonnie Hunt.
I love Bonnie Hunt so much. She was very funny in this. She played Michael McKean's wife. Sarah Rue is in it.
Okay.
Who was in Popular later. One of my favorite of the Murray brothers, Joel Murray.
Okay.
It was a fun show. It was only on for 2 seasons. It was a mid-season replacement twice. I loved it, and no one else likes it, but I still have them all on DVD, and I watch them frequently. So Friday night, the final night in the TV Guide Week, what do you go with?
I started with Full House.
So you were in the right age group for this.
Yeah.
It was still on Friday nights in 1990. It was a cornerstone of TGIF. Mm-hmm. We all watched it.
Yeah.
Driving Miss Stephanie. Ugh. You really don't want to see a Driving Miss Daisy reference in your sitcom.
No.
Probably won't win any awards from Danny when he finds out she's backed Joey's car into the kitchen.
Oh, boy.
Boof. Bad times. I watched it, and it's not a great show.
See, I think a lot of my early... Like a young boy would be, it was for what gentlemen were on that show that I found.
Oh, you found him hunky.
Yeah.
It was a hunky factor.
A little bit.
So John Stamos?
No.
Joey?
Yeah.
Okay. And you weren't into Saget, I imagine.
No.
Yeah.
To ultimate father. He's like way dad. The other ones were like...
It was very weird. I did a week of shows with him a couple summers ago.
Damn.
Extremely nice guy.
Yeah.
I talked to him a bunch. And like, I was... really cool with it, weirdly. And I was like, this is very weird. And then, like, the night before the last show, I was about to drive to the venue, and I started, like, freaking out a little bit, because I'm like, I watch this guy every Friday and every Sunday. This is very strange.
Yeah.
It was very, very strange. It was a fun show. There was no hunk factor for me.
Yeah, right.
So you're into Joey Gladstone.
A little bit, yeah.
Is that what made you want to do stand-up comedy?
No, I think for me it was always just like, who's the goofy one? That's the one I like. I had a big crush on like Robin Williams. Like,
really?
Growing up. Yeah, like him as Popeye was like a big thing for me. In that movie, Popeye.
I don't know what to say.
I know. It's weird. We could have a whole...
Serial killers and goofy weirdos. Who do weird voices?
Yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, I don't know. We could get into a whole thing about it.
Jim Carrey?
Yeah.
All right,
like in The Mask or something.
In The Mask, specifically.
No, not that. Not The Mask.
I really like the homicidal green face thing.
What else? Yeah, Ace Ventura. Like, he was like super...
Wow, Ace Ventura? But you weren't like, wow, he's so annoying.
No, I thought he was hilarious.
Wow.
I mean, I was young, you know what I mean? I thought
You still think he's hilarious?
No. No.
Okay. I could see if you were like Jim Carrey and Earth Girls Are Easy.
Sure. But that would be like Jeff Goldblum.
Well, yeah, who doesn't like Jeff Goldblum?
Right.
Yeah, I probably would have gone with Full House, although there were two special shows on this week. The Brady's.
Okay.
Which was an hour-long attempt to return the Brady Bunch to television as a drama.
Weird.
Very strange.
Huh.
Rare instance of a drama spinning off from a comedy.
Right.
It stemmed from A Very Brady Christmas, which was a special the year before.
Mm-hmm.
And in this one, brotherly love is lost between Greg and Peter. Mike weighs family requests for his financial backing in two separate ventures. Martha Quinn was on it. It was a lot of drama. It was very much like 30-something, like people were cheating on each other and were alcoholics and had no money.
What?
And yeah, it was not a funny show. It was strictly a drama.
Were they all on it or just like some?
Everybody except the girl who played Cindy.
Okay.
But everyone else was on it. Even Eve Plum.
That's so weird.
Who was not into it, but she was on it. Yeah, everybody.
Well, I guess that's probably the only option they had. Right?
Yeah, it didn't last very long. People did not want to see the Brady's.
That's freaking weird.
This night, so March 9, 1990, was actually the last time it aired.
Wow.
It only aired about 6 episodes, and people were like, nope, not having it.
Yeah.
Not having it.
Little piece of television history.
Also, American Dream Contest was on. And this was a documentary, 12 short films based on ideas submitted by students aged 9 to 17 about America's special qualities. I've never seen this, but this sounds amazing. Included a boy's fantasy tour of Americana with Mikhail Gorbachev.
What?
It gets better.
No.
a talkative quill pen voiced by Victoria Jackson.
What?
Used to sign the Declaration of Independence.
Oh my God.
A spontaneous show of patriotism at a high school basketball game. A teen's time travel to 1610 Jamestown, and then it specifies Virginia, and a Vietnamese girl's true story of escape. How amazing does that show
wow.
sound? Victoria Jackson as the voice of a patriotic that's, quill pen.
That's where it all stemmed from,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, she got
her
a little... Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I would have watched... I would have been torn between that and the Brady's, and Baywatch was not.
Yeah, well...
I mean,
yeah.
Who's not going to watch one of those three things?
Yep, yep.
So, what'd you watch at 9 o'clock?
Wait, Full House...
Oh, I'm sorry. Full House was... It was... Yeah, at 8:30 you went with Family Matters, I imagine.
I did, yeah. Yep.
So this was sort of when it started to get a little Urkel heavy, but not quite yet.
Yeah.
It was still sort of rooted in reality. So Harriet gives Carl the benefit of the doubt when he's on an all-night stakeout with an attractive partner.
Ooh.
Until she finds a room key in Louise's love grotto. To Louise's love grotto in Carl's pocket, which apparently is a motel that they felt the need to specifically name check in the description.
Super weird.
What motel is it? If it's not the love grotto, I'm not interested. And I'm not buying it. Yeah, so I would not have watched that. I would have been watching something else.
Okay.
And probably on Nickelodeon, they were airing a thing called Rich Hall's TV Dinner Party, and I would watch anything with Rich Hall.
Interesting.
So 9 o'clock, would you go with?
I did Die Hard. Close it out.
I was never a huge Die Hard person.
Really?
Yeah.
You just don't like Bruce Willis.
I just can't get into him.
Why? He's too macho?
He's kind of a smug prick.
He's a little smug.
Yeah.
But people like that.
I'll tell you, there's three words that I'll tell you why I don't like Bruce Willis.
Okay.
Return of Bruno.
Ooh.
Those are the three words why I don't love Bruce Willis.
All right.
So Perfect Strangers was on. I probably would watch that. But this was the debut of a show that intrigues me a little bit. I'm unfamiliar with this show.
Okay.
It was a 60-minute crime drama called Nasty Boys. It gets better. The description, it says, the Nasties infiltrate a casino gun-running operation to learn who's supplying Los Angeles' gang members with automatic weapons.
Whoa.
And then it tells us some of the character names here. We have Wheeler,
uh-huh.
Keepy, Chief Bradley, okay. Boring. Then we have someone, Jackie Bloom,
yep.
Busy Bee, Teeny, Baby Blue Costello, and Bobby Don Frobby.
Oh, man.
I mean, this is a show that needs a resurgence.
You're
Nasty
right.
Boys? The Nasties?
Look into it.
Yeah, I'm going to look into trying to find some Nasty Boys. Also, I must mention, at 10 o'clock, the only show my parents wouldn't let me watch was on 2020. And I feel obligated
what?
To read. I was,
why?
Because I used to be scared of everything on it. So
okay.
If it was like,
makes sense.
Yeah,
it's like there's a lot of AIDS and drugs right now
going
on.
And so this one says, scheduled an investigative report on the plight of migrant workers who harvest sugarcane fields in South Florida.
Horrifying.
Appropriate.
Yes.
Do you ever see any of those people in South Florida? According to the segment, bad working conditions, inadequate food, and poor housing are the norm at many sugar plantations.
Yep.
So like I would watch that and not let my parents buy sugar.
Right. And not drink, not cane syrup. You guys don't even have cane syrup here.
What's cane syrup?
Yeah, it's gross. It's like a black bitter syrup they make out of cane, like the cane
is
stalks.
It like poor people sugar? What
no, it's like
for?
My dad pours it on biscuits and stuff, and I would never eat. I only liked...
Is there like any southern food that you miss? Like some kind of...
I miss... I actually make it now, but salty cornbread, because everyone here eats
makes
sweet
it
cornbread.
Sweet. Yeah, we do. Yeah.
Yeah, so I like... And I make every New Year's Day, I make black-eyed peas and...
Oh, that's pretty good.
And collards.
Oh, I love the collards.
And cornbread.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, I can back that.
All right.
So finally, Lillian, as you know, TV Guide is not just informative.
Sure.
It is opinionated,
mm-hmm.
and it cheers, and it jeers. So I will read you the cheers and jeers from this week and see if you agree
okay.
or disagree. So first we have a cheers to Night Music, the syndicated music show that does what MTV is afraid to do, be cool. With saxophonist David Sanborn as host and Saturday Night Live's Lorne Michaels as executive producer, the show presents an eclectic mix of musical acts. Featured artists have included punk rockers the Red Hot Chili Peppers, rockers Sonic Youth and Todd Rundgren, avant-garde performance artists, and Thelonious Monk.
I agree with that.
You're
that's
agreeing
great.
With
Avant-garde
that cheer.
Avant-garde and
cool.
Thelonious, those are cool people.
Who doesn't love punk rockers, the Red Hot Chili Peppers? Next, we have a jeers to CBS's Pat Sajak show. It'd be funny if that's all it said.
Exactly.
For its new Bachelor from Hell stage set, the nihilistic design with its cold, dark backdrop, oversized leather chairs, and futuristic coffee table.
That sounds amazing.
I like this. Is about as inviting and warm as a hypodermic syringe. Who designed this atrocity anyway? RoboCop?
I want to see the catty person just writing these.
I just picture a guy doing that whole jeer on stage in a stand-up club in 1990. Who's designing this thing? RoboCop?
No, I think that's great.
I'm going to disagree with that. Yeah, that should be a cheer.
Yeah.
This is a cheer that's going to warm your heart.
All right.
Cheers to Patrick Stewart, who plays Captain Jean-Luc Picard on the syndicated Star Trek The Next Generation. The British-born Stewart's command of the Starship Enterprise is surpassed only by his mellifluous command of the mother tongue. Thanks to his training as a Shakespearean actor, he fills predecessor William Shatner's shoes with his convincing portrayal of a leader who's both authoritative and empathetic.
Does that not convince you, Ken?
I don't know. I might watch it now.
I'm telling you.
What a nerdy... This sounds like some fat kid's high school report. Let me tell you about someone I admire. Patrick Stewart's command of the Starship Enterprise is surpassed only by his mellifluous command of the mother tongue. Like, that is not... Who speaks like that? There's no... So you're agreeing with that cheer?
Yeah, come on.
And finally, Lillian, CBS is getting all the jeers here after their Pat Sajak RoboCop set.
They're the old people jeer, right?
Jeers to CBS's 48 Hours for turning soft. Having covered psychic phenomenon, a beauty pageant, and now Paul McCartney's world tour.
First of all, way ahead of their time, because everything would be soft. Also, they said something else was too hard and cold, so
where they want.
Come on.
Mixed messages, TV guy.
Exactly.
So you've disagreed with almost all the jeers, and you've agreed with both of the jeers.
Yeah, you know, positivity. Yeah.
Well, Lillian Devane, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you. It was super fun.
Thank you.
Yeah.
There you have it. That was my episode with Lillian Devane. There's some pretty interesting stuff in there. Serial killers, ahoy. Never was my thing, but apparently it was hers. So that's a fun episode. Thank you guys so much. Please continue to email me at KenAndICanRead with anything, any feedback, any questions, any corrections. I always love hearing from you guys. Or join our Facebook page, TV Guidance Counselor, on the Tumblr page. There's usually clips and some further discussion. So you can check that out there. And I think that you will enjoy being part of that community, as I enjoy having you as a listener. So thank you so much, and I'll see you again next week on TV Guidance Counselor.